That was really loud. I'm sorry. I just felt the urge to just come up here and speak. Jacob gave me 2 minutes. 30 seconds. I have always struggled in life with fitting in and not knowing, you know, where I need to be and what I need to do. And I'm not going to cry. My daughter encouraged me, more or less forced me, but encouraged me to join the Monday night women's Bible study. And I was like, oh gosh, Caitlin, you know, I don't know these people, they don't know me, yada, yada, yada. This past weekend, I had the opportunity, and Jeffrey's supposed to show a picture. I had the opportunity to go to this retreat with women that I had never really carried on a conversation with before. And it's been a long time since I felt that much love and belonging and knowing that for the first time in a very long time that this is where God wanted me to be. And so Kathy and I sang songs from the 70s. I learned a new love for all of these ladies that never would I have ever known if my daughter would not have encouraged me to come with her to Monday night Bible studies. So I am just here to let you all know that if you have Monday nights free from 6:30 to 8, I really encourage you to just give it a try because these women are amazing. And I have never been told in my life I love you that much. And I know that I'm loved, and I know that's where I belong. And I just want to thank each woman. And most of us have on shirts from the event. And I just want to encourage you, if you have the opportunity on Monday nights, you belong. I'm the third youngest, but it doesn't matter the age because I know that Sharon, I'm going to cry looking at all these women. I just know that this is where God wanted me to be and needs me to be. And I just want to encourage all of you women, if you have a free moment, just come and see what it's about. And you will never feel so much love in your life that you do surrounded by these women of all ages. So that's what I wanted to share with you.
Do I do it under 2 minutes?
All right, thank you so much, Shauna. All right, got a few announcements. Good afternoon, everybody, which is weird to say, but glad everybody could make it today as well. So, okay, I've got a couple of announcements. I'm going to save the longest one for last. So November 12th is the fish fry. The sign-ups are still out on the information desk. So please go ahead and get signed up if you want to come for that, and please bring a side. On behalf of Valita and the rest of the finance committee, if you have not got your budget request in, please do so as soon as possible. If there's any children here age 5 through 2nd grade that want to go to Children's Church, they can go ahead and head that way now, just so you guys know that we're going to start dismissing them as soon as we get service started. Finally, FBC is doing a float for the Christmas parade, which is on November 13th. If you want to be a part of that, we're going to be walking down Main Street or down 2nd Street next to the float during the parade, handing out candy canes. We're going to arrive at the 1912 building by 6 p.m., and you need to wear Hawaiian attire. So note all of that stuff, and we will try to announce it again next week so nobody forgets. November 13th, come hand out candy canes to everybody. So, and I'm going to hand the mic over to Joe Leitz.
Well, thank you, Colin. I rise today on behalf of the Personnel Committee. I bring you good news. God has answered our prayers. In unanimous vote, we bring T.C. Shippey before the congregation to serve as our youth pastor. We'll have an opportunity to hear from him in both services next week. He'll rise and give a brief testimony. We'll be able to meet him at the fish fry. Please come and join us there. T.C. will preach the message for us at the end of the month, both the morning and the evening services. And then we'll hold a special business meeting on the 10th to bring this to its conclusion. But your prayers have been answered. God has blessed us. Thank you so much. The Apostle Paul says, greet one another with a holy kiss. That may be a little too much for some of us, but a holy fist bump. Let's greet one another with a holy hug. Let's pass the peace of Christ.
Amen. Hey, if they need a high Hawaiian shirt, they can borrow one from you. They need a high Hawaiian shirt, they can borrow one from you.
I would say good morning, but it's good afternoon, and I feel all thrown off, as I think many of you guys have. I hope you enjoyed a restful Sunday morning. This was quite different in so many ways to wake up, watch some football, and then come to church afterwards. Very different, throws everybody off. But we are so thankful and grateful to be in the house of the Lord, to sing His praise, to worship Him, and what a wonderful opportunity that we have to sing and worship together. So as we begin our time of worship, if you will, please bow with me as we dedicate this time to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for who you are, for what you've done. Lord, we're just so thankful that we can gather in your house, even though it is an odd hour of Sunday. But Lord, we're so grateful and thankful that we can worship you, the true, the living God who loves us, who gave himself for us, so that we can have life in Christ. Lord, I just thank you for the time that we have together. I pray that everything that we say and do would bring glory to your name. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Good afternoon, which is kind of hard to say, but it's good to see everybody here this morning. Good to see a couple of people in the house. I got to recognize Dennis and Becky. It's good to see you guys back.
Yay!
And then a good old friend from, or a good friend, not necessarily old. We've been friends a long time, you know, at least 15 years. That's maybe old. 45 or 50, anyway. Kathy, good to have you and your granddaughter here with us. We grew up in the same church over in Raytown, so it's good to see them, and it's good to see everybody in the house today. We're going to start off by singing together. We've heard the joyful sound, and that sound is what? Jesus saves. Amen.
Amen.
All right, Susan.
Triumph o'er the
Let the nations now rejoice. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Shout salvation full and free. By his tills the deepest caves, this our song of victory. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow.
Shauna laid the groundwork for it really quite well. It's called Place for Me, just saying that there's a place for me in the house of God. And really the meaning of this song is more that we are all just sinners saved by grace. Amen. Nobody in here can look down their nose at anybody else and say, well, I'm more righteous than you. Amen.
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 Okay. And so anyway, thank God. We can all come into this building. There's a place at the table for everybody.
Absolutely.
that's here and all those who are outside the walls of this place. Amen?
Amen.
Because God has made that avenue available through the blood of Jesus. Hallelujah. All right. I don't have to be perfect to get inside the door. I don't have to be good to be loved. If it's true that my words are what the healer is looking for, then it's a good thing I've got more than enough.
Make a place for me in the company of sinners saved by grace. Here among the broken underneath, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus, make a place for me.
If the losers and the lowly are the ones that you call blessed, if my weakness shows the power of your blood, if my failures preach the gospel more than my success, then it's a good thing I've got more than enough. Hallelujah, there's a place for me in the company of sinners saved by grace. Here among the broken underneath, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus, there's a place for me.
part of the family now. I know I belong, if I'm up or if I'm down. I know I belong. I was blind, but now I see. I know I belong. All I know is it's saving me. I know I belong. I know I belong. Hallelujah, there's a place for me in the company of sinners saved by grace. Here among the broken on their knees. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, there's a place for me in the company of sinners saved by grace. Here among the broken on their knees. That's the place I am changed, forgiven and set free. Hallelujah, thank you, Jesus, there's a place for me.
Jesus did on the cross. Amen. We have nothing to boast of, but just what he's done for us.
Giver of every breath that breathes, Father of all eternity.
glory, maker of heaven and of earth. No one can comprehend your worth. He knows all the universe. Give me the glory. And I am alive because I'm alive in you. And it's all because of Jesus I'm alive. It's all because the blood of Jesus Christ covers me and raises them and twice. It's all because of Jesus I'm alive.
Thank you for the precious blood of Jesus that was shed for us, that we could have eternal salvation, Lord. Thank you so much for that great price that was paid on the cross. Father, we thank you for this opportunity to be here this afternoon to worship freely. And Father, we pray that you'll open our hearts to what you want to say through Jacob as he brings us the word now. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you, Jim. Turn once again to the book of Ephesians, if you will. Turning once again to the book of Ephesians, and we're going to jump right into it in just a moment. Hopefully you guys had a restful Sunday morning. Any of you, is this just odd, waking up, not coming to church? Man, this was just weird for me. Just thinking, how many times does this ever happen that I actually don't have to wake up and like on my games first thing Sunday morning? It was nice, not going to lie, to kind of have a little bit slower morning, but I'm excited that we can be here. Man, just so we're all on the same page, that Chiefs game was rough second half. That was rough, okay? Let's just be real here. We would have had some major confessions to bring this morning had that maybe gone a different direction, right? We struggle with that. We all like to get passionate about our sports, don't we? We love having fun. We love talking smack. We love to cheer against Denver, even though let's not bring that up, right? Yeah, sorry. Well, here's the reality. We all love our sports teams, and I know this is going to get a reaction, but if I say rock chalk, there you go. That's what I'm hoping for. You get a reaction out of it, right? It's deep-rooted. It's something like, don't like that guy anymore, and immediately half of you guys shut me off, like not listening to him ever again. We love sports. We love the competition. We love like that just excitement that comes along with it, and we love cheering for the bad guys against them to lose. Like whoever's playing against them, we like to cheer like their loss sometimes even better than our own team sometimes, right? It's just the way we are. Well, here we're going to jump into a passage that talks about something of a rivalry that's taking place. There's some struggles that are taking place here. And we're going to jump into a situation that's a lot more than just sports. There's a lot more going on in this passage than just the nice, friendly rivalry of team competition that's taking place here. See, Paul is writing this letter to the church at Ephesus, and he realizes there are some major things that are struggles within the church. There's some conflict. There's some tension taking place, and it's a lot more than just which college team or professional NFL team that you cheer for. This is some deep-rooted stuff that we're talking about today. And so we are going to jump in to Ephesians chapter 2, beginning in verse 11, is where we're going to begin today. And I want to remind us of where we just came from last week, because the beginning of chapter 11 says, "So then," that says, because of everything that I've just told you, everything that we've just talked about, so then let's talk about this. We got to remember where we were last week. Last week we talked about the reality that every single one of us are dead in trespasses of sin. This is the condition of all humanity. You were once dead. All of us. Not a single one of us, as Jim just said, has the nose up on anybody. We were all dead. So then, let's keep going. Because we all start off in the same grave. We all start off in the same condition. We all start off in the same spiritual state of deadness. But God made us alive. But God has done a work in our hearts, in each and every single one of us, so that you are alive. You are spiritually alive today. So then, let's continue. Let's continue with what we are to learn. So then, beginning in verse 11, so then, remember that at one time you were Gentiles in the flesh, called the uncircumcised by those called the circumcised, which is done in the flesh by human hands. At that time, you were without the Messiah, excluded from the citizenship of Israel, and foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope and without God in the world. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who were far away have been brought near by the blood of the Messiah. For he is our peace, who made both groups one and tore down the dividing wall of hostility in the flesh, in his flesh. He made of no effect the law consisting of commands and expressed in regulations, so that he might create in himself one new man from two, resulting in peace. He did this so that he might reconcile both to God in one body through the cross and put the hostility to death by it. When the Messiah came, he proclaimed the good news of peace to you who were far away and peace to those who were near. For through him, we both have access by one Spirit to the Father. So then, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with the saints and members of God's household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. The whole building being put together by him grows into a holy sanctuary in the Lord. You also are being built together for God's dwelling in the Spirit. Let's pray as we begin our time together. Dear Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you for the promises and the power of your word. Lord, I thank you for this passage. Lord, as we open this passage, Lord, I pray that you would remove any preconceived ideas and thoughts that any of us may have and allow you to just speak, Lord. May we hear your voice. Hide me behind the cross, Lord. I pray that your word would be proclaimed and challenge each and every single one of us to be conformed more to the image of Jesus Christ. We thank you for who you are, for what you've done. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So then, he says, remember. What are you supposed to remember? Remember the fact that you were all Gentiles. You were Gentiles. You weren't of the household of Israel. You were not a part of the chosen people of God. We're to recall this. Recall that we were dead men who have been made alive in Christ. But remember, at one time, we were all Gentiles. Guys, this has relevancy to us today, okay? Okay, this is going to speak to all of us, because this talks about a very deep-rooted connection that we all have. The fact is, we are all human. We are all human, and there are struggles that humans have with one another. This is a condition where it says that, look, the Jews and the Gentiles haven't always gotten along. Have any evidence of that today? Maybe. Does any of this strike an accord yet, that people have difficulty communicating and talking and getting along with one another? Oh, man, absolutely. Absolutely. This is going to have a lot to do with our lives today. Let's talk about this difference of the Jews and Gentiles for just a second. Biblically speaking, who are the Jews? They were God's chosen people. They were the ones who were given the promise of God. You will be my people. I will be your God. They were chosen by God. They were his. They were his elect ones. They were the ones who received God's covenant, God's promise, God's blessing. They knew who they were. And the world around them also understood who they were and what they thought of themselves. You see, biblically, the Jews understood that just as God chose Adam to be his image bearer, and then he chose Seth after Cain killed Abel to be the line, and then he chose to use Noah, and the story goes on. He chose Abraham. He chose Jacob. He chose Judah. He chose David, and the line goes on until we get to the person of Jesus Christ. God chose, but they knew, the Jews knew, they were chosen people of God. They were the chosen family of God. They had this mentality, because they were the chosen people, that everybody else was outsiders. Everybody else was outsiders. There was a clear line. You're either part of this family or you're not. You're either part of this nation or you're not. It says it right there. It talks about it very clearly. See, the Jews looked at the Gentiles as unholy. They were unclean. They were despised. They were ritually impure. They were not allowed into the temple of God. They weren't. In fact, when the Jew would walk from one village to another, if he arrived in a Gentile town, as he would leave, he'd take his shoes off, dust the dirt off of his shoes so he wouldn't contaminate his own town going back into his city. He wanted nothing to do with that place. Wanted nothing to do with those heathen. There was a strong sense of these people are not God's people. But the division doesn't stop there. The Greeks also had this mentality. The Greeks also looked at everybody else who was not Greek, and they called them the barbarians. They called them the unsophisticated ones. there were some serious ethnic problems that these people struggled with. See, we have this reality that Paul is writing to. He's writing to these people who, and he's stepping right in the middle of ethical and ethnic wars. Racial tension is taking place in this church. And he's saying, look, you are all in Christ now. That's what he's getting at. In Christ, these barriers go away. In Christ, all this tension that you have felt your entire life from this group or that group is gone. What is it that you're struggling over? But he recognizes that this tension is very real. He points it out. So that's number one in our outline. Paul highlights the division of the nations without Christ. He says it right there. Look at it. Let's read it again in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 11. So then, remember that at one time you were Gentiles in the flesh, called the uncircumcised by those that are called circumcised. He's pointing it out. You're either Jews or you're not. Jews or Gentiles. Which is done by human hands. He says at that time, and let's point out a few of these things. You can either underline these, highlight them down, or just mark them in your outline. Look at the list that he goes on. He says, you were without the Messiah. You were excluded from the citizenship of Israel. You were foreigners to the covenant and the promise. You were without hope. You were without God. It's pretty clear. He makes it very obvious. There are two different groups of people here. Humanly speaking, there is a huge divide. Humanly speaking, there is a huge divide between these two people groups. He says, I want you to remember, Paul writes this, I want you to remember that you were the ethos, is the word. You are the different ethnic. You are the Gentiles, is what he says. You are different than the Jews. Now, I don't typically reference this Bible translation often, but I'm going to today because it makes a very clear and very distinct understanding of what's taking place here. The NLT says this, don't forget that you Gentiles used to be the outsiders. You were called the uncircumcised heathens by the Jews, who were proud of their circumcision, even though it affected only their bodies and not their hearts. Gets to the heart of it. It gets straight to the heart of it. See, the reality is there is two groups of people in the Jewish mentality. There's only two. There's the chosen family and those who are not of the chosen family. But Paul takes this concept and updates it to its new, true reality. It is no longer about being in the chosen family or outside of the chosen family. It's about being in Christ or not in Christ. He says it's all about being in Christ. He introduces this church to this new reality of being in Christ. Lloyd-Jones explains it this way. The division seems absolute. And any talk about reconciliation seems monstrous and impossible. Jews and Gentiles. You might as well say Jews and dogs. But on the other hand, the Gentiles had their classification, and particularly the Greeks. The whole world from them was divided up into Greeks and barbarians. It is either the knowledgeable people, the philosophers, the Greeks on one hand, or the ignoramus, illiterate barbarians on the other. There is tension taking place within this church that Paul is getting at. He's getting at the very heart of the matter. The Jews had this sense of self-righteousness, self-absorption, pat themselves on the back. Paul is writing to this and saying, pointing out the fact of the matter is this. You Jews look at the work of circumcision as something to pat yourselves on the back and be proud of. He says, this is done by human hands. He says, this is the same as adding artificial sweetener or artificial flavor to the Kool-Aid. It's artificial. It's made up. It's not natural. It's not a natural thing. This is not getting to the spiritual root of it. It's putting the outward appearance on it. He's saying there's so much more than this. What I'm trying to explain to you is simply this. Racial and ethnic struggles are not new. It's not new to our world. Paul dealt with it. Paul is stepping into the middle of a conversation that is fierce and emotionally charged. The response to Paul would have been, "How dare you? How dare you speak of such things to say that we are equal? How dare you make a statement that the Jew is equal to the Greek? How dare you make the statement that the Greek is equal to the barbarian? How dare you make such claims? How can you?" But Paul is reaching beyond what the eye can see and beyond what is normal for these people to think about. There is a unity in Christ. If you are unified in the Spirit, then how can you possibly be divided in the flesh? If we are unified in the Spirit of God, then how can we possibly be divided here in the flesh? It's not possible. That's his point. It's not possible. You are in Christ. You are one in him. The division is gone. That's what Paul is getting at. He's telling us that there is a new reality in Christ Jesus. So let's go on to point number two. Paul highlights the unity of the nations in Christ. I love what it says in verse 13. But now, it has the same resonance as Ephesians 2:4, where it says, but God. But now in Christ, you who were once far. By the way, this is me. I was the one who was once far. This is speaking of us, the people that were not of Israel. I was the one who was far off. I was the one that Paul is speaking to here. He says, but now in Christ Jesus, you who were far away have been brought near by the blood of the Messiah. For he is our peace, who made both groups one and tore down the dividing wall of hostility. In his flesh, he made of no effect the law consisting of commands and expressed in regulations, so that he might create in himself, what's it say? One new man from two, resulting in peace. A couple things I want to point out here. First of all, what has he done? He's brought us near. He's brought us near. He is our peace. Both groups are one. He tore down this dividing wall. He nullified the effect of the law by causing division. He points this out. Look, the Jewish law, the ethnical differences, the cultural, the politics, the religious, all of this was deeply rooted within this culture. It was deeply rooted within Ephesus. They understood the tension that was taking place here, and Paul is now saying we are to all worship together, and they're struggling with this reality. They grew up, Jews who didn't associate with Gentiles are now worshiping the same Lord, and they're trying to work through this. And the Greeks, who think that everybody else is barbarians in their eyes, are now all of a sudden worshiping with Jews and Romans and Scythians. What is this? How do you work through this? And this is what Paul is getting at, that Christ has torn down the walls. We should be excited about that. But now in Christ, those who were once dead, those who were once alienated, those who were once foreigners, those who were once enemies, those who were once hostile, but now we are one in Christ. Come on, guys, we should be excited about this. See, this passage is talking about me. It's talking about each of us. We were once alienated. We were once dead. We were once enemies. We were once hostile in Christ. But now in Christ, there is no division. There is no division. There is no separation. Why? It says it right here. Because of the blood of Jesus Christ. This is the hinge. This is the central truth upon which everything is latched. Upon everything hinges upon this, the blood of Jesus Christ. It's all about his sacrifice. This is the central theme, the central message. This is the turning point for all. Because once you come to Jesus Christ, the road that you are traveling, no matter what your background is, has turned to be in Christ. It is all about his blood and the redemption for all. And when we step into that, we are one in him. This is what Christ has done for me, for you. You see, when Jesus Christ came to earth and he paid the sacrifice for my sin and for your sin and the sins of all mankind, he did something extraordinary. He did something absolutely extraordinary. He did something that would fix my relationship not only vertically with my Lord, but horizontally with mankind. He healed this relationship so this relationship could be healed. He did a work in my heart with my Father, in your heart with your Father, in your heart with your Father, so that our relationship could be restored. Because we put up walls. Every single one of us has walls that we put up. Every single one of us, whether we want to admit it or not, we put up walls. But God has come to tear down those walls, to bring hope and healing and restoration. While sin destroys, God heals. While sin divides, Jesus brings unity and restoration. This is what Christ has done. When Jesus died on the cross, he fixed not only my vertical, but also horizontal relationships. This is what Christ has done. You see, at the foot of the cross, all those walls, all those barriers, all those things that have built up in my heart, my mind, comes crashing down. There's no room for them at the foot of the cross. I've got to lay it down. That's what Christ did. He tore down the dividing walls. He tore down the dividing walls between me and him, and he tore down the dividing walls between me and you. Because when we are in Christ, there is no division. We are one in him. This is what Christ has done. Look at what Christ has done. You see, diversity in the church simply testifies to the work of Jesus Christ. When we see that there is differences in backgrounds, there's differences in families, we should rejoice because this is seeing the work of Jesus Christ. And you know what? We should probably get used to it because that's what heaven's going to look like. Praise the Lord. God is at work. We should be excited about the diversity of cultural backgrounds in our church. We should celebrate because this is the work of Jesus Christ taking place in our hearts. God has come to restore. Let's keep on rolling. Number three, Paul highlights the reconciliation of the hostility when we are in Christ. He highlights that there is reconciliation of the hostility. Verse 16. He did this so that he might reconcile both to God in one body through the cross and put the hostility to death by it. When the Messiah came, he proclaimed the good news of peace to you who are far away and peace to those who were near. For through him, we both have access by one Spirit to the Father. Look what he says. We are one new man. This is resulting in peace. We will be reconciled. There's one body. Christ came to save all. He came to save the world. He came not just to be Savior to the Jews. He came not just to be the Savior of the Palestinians. He came not just to be the Savior of the Arabs or the Europeans or the Asians or the Africans or no matter what background. He came to be the Savior of all. He came to redeem all who would call upon his name. He is the Savior to all. So when we are in Christ, we are united in him. Galatians chapter 3, verse 27 says, "For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ like a garment. Therefore, there is no Jew or Greek, no slave or free, no male or female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus." Doesn't matter our background. Palestinian, Israeli, Russian, Ukrainian, Saudi, or Iranian, China, United States. None of this matters when you are in Christ. Not a thing. It does not matter when you are in Christ. Jesus Christ has come to tear down the walls of division. He's come to tear down the walls of hate. He's come to tear down the walls of racism. He's come to tear down the walls of separation. That's what Christ has done. You are in Christ. You are in a new family, the church. And I'm not just talking about this building. When I say the church, I mean the family of God. That's your family. We have a new family. We have a new Savior, a new Father, new brothers, new sisters. This is what Christ has done and Christ has accomplished. He has given me a new family. He's given you a new family to unify God and man and to unify man and reconcile the what was once divisions. I don't know what your background is. I don't know your family tree. I don't know what hurts you have in the past or what things have caused you or to push you one way or another, but I do know this, that in Christ there is no division. There is no distinction. In him there is unity. In him we are one. Colossians 3:11 says this, "In Christ there is not Greek or Jew, circumcision or uncircumcision, barbarian, Scythian, slave, and free, but Christ is all and in all." Number four, Paul highlights the new temple in Christ. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 19 says this, "So then, you are no longer foreigners and strangers." Can I get an amen? Hey, we're no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with the saints and members of God's household. I want to point out a few things here. Look at all this when it talks about the temple of God. We are the new temple. So I'm going to try to give emphasis. You might want to highlight these words or underline them. We are all members of God's household. We are built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets with Christ himself as the cornerstone. The whole building being put together by him, growing into a holy sanctuary. You also are being built together for God's dwelling in the Spirit. Did you catch all of those? I've got 9 points there, 9 different words where he points out the reality of we are his temple. The church is the new temple. The church, not this building, I'm talking about the people, are his temple. The dwelling place of God on earth. We've talked a little bit about the city of Ephesus. We talked about the great temple that was there, one of the 7 wonders of the ancient world, the largest Greek temple ever constructed. You could have seen this temple from pretty much anywhere in the city. They knew where their God lived, right? Paul is making a point that's very clear. You are to be that temple. Everybody had in their mind what a temple looked like and the purpose of it. Everybody knew. If you were a Jew, you used to worship in Jerusalem. You understood the reality of that temple. If you're a Greek, you understood what a Greek temple was, what it looked like. If you're Roman or Scythian, doesn't matter. You knew what a temple looked like and what it was there for. And Paul says, that's you. When people walked into Ephesus, they could see that temple from miles away. Oh, the glory, they would think. Oh, the wonder. Oh, the power. But God is doing so much greater in his church. He is at work in something so much more incredible than a temple built by stone. He is putting together a body of people, of individuals from different backgrounds to collectively be his temple, his dwelling place on earth. And as Paul writes this letter to the church at Ephesus, he says, as people travel from the distant far east, as they travel from Rome from the west, as they travel up from Jerusalem, as they travel down from the different places across the world, they are going to come into this place called Ephesus. And they are going to see a diverse group of people with different backgrounds, fellowshipping together, being the collective temple of God. That's what God is up to. Church of Odessa, you are the temple. We are to be that shining light in this area of the world. This is God's dwelling place. Here, in you. We are to make that abundantly clear to all who come here, that this is where Christ lives. This is where the God of the universe resides and is at work, here and there. We are to be on clear display that this is the dwelling place of God. It's not a temple of stone. It is a temple of people, that Jesus Christ is the chief cornerstone, building up his church, one church, from all sorts of different backgrounds. That's what Christ is doing. That's what Christ has done. Paul points this out. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16 says, don't you yourselves know that you are God's sanctuary and that the Spirit of God lives in you? And if anyone destroys God's sanctuary, God will destroy him, for God's sanctuary is holy, and that is what you are. Romans chapter 12, verse 1 says, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, I urge you to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual worship. This is temple language. We are to operate as a temple to represent. This is the dwelling place of God on earth. All of us. That is what we are called to do. This is what it means to be the temple. This is what it means to be the sanctuary of the Lord. We are to be reflective. We are to be the temple of the Lord here in this place. We are to display Jesus Christ to the world around us. May this church completely, all of us, be unified in him and display his glory of what Christ is doing. You see, I don't know what your background is, whether you struggle with different things or not, but I'm here to let you know that God has destroyed the dividing walls of hostility between all of us. Whatever it is that you're struggling with, God is here to restore. If we want to look at one other thing real quick, how did Jesus treat the different people? Different backgrounds. Samaritan woman, he reached out to her, showed her love and care and compassion, not only to her, but to her entire family, to all her family members. Romans, he did work in them. To the non-Jew, to the lady that came begging, he reached out. You see, I want this church to not be defined by anything other than the cross of Jesus Christ. It's not about the colors. It's not about the red, the white, and the blue. It's not even about the red, white, and blue. It's about the cross. In Him, there is unity. In Him, we are one. It's not about anything other than what Jesus Christ has done. Jews or Gentiles, barbarians, Greeks, it doesn't matter. Paul says that they should see Christ for all nations. As they see us, as the other nations see us, they should see Christ as we are in Him. The question is, are you in Him? Are you in Christ? Have you taken that step and said, yes, I trust in the Lord Jesus Christ as my personal Savior and Lord? Have you laid your sin at the altar? Because at the altar of the cross, there is no division. He has torn down the walls of division between me and God and you and God. All you do is you must come to Him. And when you come to Him, He will not only tear down the walls of division between you and Almighty God, but between you and your fellow man. Praise God for what He has done. Praise God for who He is. Praise God that in Christ, we are one. Let's pray. Dear Father.